the fourth Sunday in Lent. It's Letarde Sunday. Hope that's right for those who know how to pronounce Latin in an excellent way, because that's not me. I do my best. So we're using the color rose, recognizing that in normal times, this would be a day that we relax our Lenten disciplines and exert joy and gratefulness and things of that nature. And we still do that, especially in the fact that we are not in normal times. We're all in a time that's unprecedented, but we're called to yet and still gather with joy to give thanks to God and further trust that God is with us in this particular time, and God will see us through and we'll get through this together. So we're going to pray morning prayer. I hope that you have access to the online resource. If not, let us know, and we'll do a correction during the week. We have a small choir that's gathered, a preacher, a deacon, and myself, the priest. So let us begin. Jesus said, "If any of you would come after me, deny yourself and take up your cross and follow me."
Let us confess our sins to God. God of all mercy,
we confess that we have sinned against you, opposing your will in our lives. We have denied your goodness in each other, in ourselves, and in the world you have created. We repent of the evil that enslaves us, the evil we have done, and the evil done on our behalf. Forgive, restore, and strengthen us through our Savior Jesus Christ, that we may abide in your love and serve only your will. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen. Amen.
O God, let our mouth proclaim your praise.
And your glory all the days long.
Praise to the holy and undivided Trinity, one God, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Our God is full of compassion and mercy. Come, let us worship.
O God, you are my God. Eagerly I seek you.
My soul thirsts for you. My flesh faints for you. As in a barren and dry land where there is no water.
Therefore I have gazed upon you in your holy place.
That I might behold your power and your glory.
For your loving kindness is better than life itself.
My lips shall give you praise.
So will I bless you as long as I live.
And lift up my hands in your name.
My soul is content as with marrow and fatness.
My mouth praises you with joyful lips.
When I remember you upon my bed,
I meditate on you in the night watches.
For you have been my helper, and
under the shadow of your wings I will rejoice.
My soul clings to you. Praise to the holy and undivided Trinity, one God, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. A reading from Paul's letter to the Ephesians. Once you were in darkness, but now in the Lord you are light. Live as children of the light. For the fruit of the light is found in all that is good and right and true. Try to find out what is pleasing to the Lord. Take no part in the unfruitful works of darkness, but instead expose them. For it is shameful even to mention what such people do secretly. But everything exposed by the light becomes visible. For everything that becomes visible is light. Therefore it says, "Sleeper, awake, rise from the dead, and Christ will shine on you." hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people.
Thanks be to God.
In unison,
beloved,
let us love one another, for love is of God. Whoever does not love does not know God, for God is love. In this, the love of God was revealed among us, that God sent his only Son into the world so that we might live through Jesus Christ.
In this we love.
Not that we love God, but that God loved us and sent his Son that sins might be forgiven. Beloved, since God loved us so much, we also ought to love one another. For if we love one another, God abides in us, and God's love will be perfected in us. A reading from John's Gospel. As Jesus walked along, he saw a man blind from birth. His disciples asked him, "Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind?" Jesus answered, "Neither this man nor his parents sinned. He was born blind so that God's works might be revealed in him. We must work the works of him who sent me while it is day. Night is coming when no one can work. As long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world." When he had said this, he spat on the ground and made mud with the saliva and spread the mud on the man's eyes, saying to him, "Go, wash in the pool of Siloam," which means sent. Then he went and washed and came back able to see. The neighbors and those who had seen him before as a beggar began to ask, "Is this not the man who used to sit and beg?" Some were saying, "It is he." Others were saying, "No, but it is someone like him." He kept saying, "I am the man." But they kept asking him, "Then how were your eyes opened?" He answered, "The man called Jesus made mud, spread it on my eyes, and said to me, 'Go to Siloam and wash.' Then I went and washed and received my sight." They said to him, "Where is he?" He said, "I do not know." They brought to the Pharisees the man who had formerly been blind. Now it was a Sabbath day when Jesus made the mud and opened his eyes. Then the Pharisees also began to ask him how he had received his sight. He said to them, "He put mud on my eyes, then I washed, and now I see." Some of the Pharisees said, "This man is not from God, for he does not observe the Sabbath." But others said, "How can a man who is a sinner perform such signs?" And they were divided. So they said again to the blind man, "What do you say about him? It was your eyes he opened." He said, "He is a prophet." The Jews did not believe that he had been blind and had received his sight until they called the parents of the man who had received his sight and asked them, "Is this your son who you say was born blind? How then does he now see?" His parents answered, "We know that this is our son and that he was born blind, but we do not know how it is that now he sees, nor do we know who opened his eyes. Ask him, he is of age, he will speak for himself." His parents said this because they were afraid of the Jews, for the Jews had already agreed that anyone who confessed Jesus to be the Messiah would be put out of the synagogue. Therefore, his parents said, "He is of age, ask him." So for the second time, they called the man who had been blind, and they said to him, "Give glory to God. We know that this man is a sinner." He answered, "I do not know whether he is a sinner. One thing I do know, that though I was blind, now I see." They said to him, "What did he do to you? How did he open your eyes?" He answered them, "I have told you already, and you would not listen. Why do you want to hear it again?" Do you also want to become his disciples? Then they reviled him, saying, You are his disciple, but we are disciples of Moses. We know that God has spoken to Moses, but as for this man, we do not know where he comes from. The man answered, Here is an astonishing thing. You do not know where he comes from, and yet he opened my eyes. We know that God does not listen to sinners, but he does listen to one who worships him and obeys his will. Never since the world began has it been heard that anyone who opened the eyes of a person born blind. If this man were not from God, he could do nothing. They answered him, You were born entirely in sins, and are you trying to teach us? And they drove him out. Jesus heard that they had driven him out, and when he found him, he said, Do you believe in the Son of Man? He answered, And who is he, sir? Tell me, so that I may believe in him. Jesus said to him, You have seen him, and the one speaking with you is he. He said, Lord, I believed, and he worshiped him. Jesus said, I came into this world for judgment, so that those who do not see may see, and those who do see may become blind. Some of the Pharisees near him heard this and said to him, Surely we are not blind, are we? Jesus said to them, If you were blind, you would not have sinned. But now that you say we see, your sin remains. Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people.
Thanks be to God.
Let us now pray responsively by half verse, Canticle 12, a song of creation. Glorify the Lord, all you works of the Lord.
Sing praise and give honor forever.
In the high vault of heaven, glorify the Lord.
Sing praise and give honor forever.
Glorify the Lord, you angels and all powers of the Lord.
O heavens and all waters above the heavens.
Sun and moon and stars of the sky, glorify the Lord.
Sing praise and give honor.
Glorify the Lord, every shower of rain and fall of dew.
All winds and fire and heat.
Winter and summer, glorify the Lord.
Sing praise and give honor forever.
Glorify the Lord, O chill and cold.
Drops of dew and flakes of snow.
Frost and cold, ice and sleet, glorify the Lord.
Sing praise.
Glorify the Lord, O nights and days,
and the shining light and the golden dawn.
Storm clouds and thunderbolts, glorify the Lord.
Sing praise and give honor forever.
Let the earth glorify the Lord.
Sing praise.
And hills and all that grows underneath the earth.
Sing praise and give honor forever.
Glorify the Lord, O springs of water, seas and streams.
O whales and all that move in the waters.
All birds of the air, glorify the Lord.
Sing praise and give honor forever.
Glorify the Lord, O beast of the wild.
And all you flocks.
O people everywhere, glorify the Lord.
Sing praise and give honor forever.
Let the people of God glorify the Lord.
Sing praise and give honor forever.
Glorify the Lord, O priests, deacons, lay people, bishops. Let us all glorify the Lord.
Sing praise.
Glorify the Lord, O spirits and souls of the righteous.
Sing praise and give honor forever.
You that are holy and humble of heart, glorify the Lord.
Sing praise and give honor forever.
Let us glorify the Lord, God the Son and the Holy Spirit.
Sing praise and give honor.
in the high vault of heaven, glorify the Lord.
Sing praise and give honor forever.
If you have a hymnal nearby, we invite you to join us in singing hymn number 8. Hymn number 8, Morning Has Broken.
Morning has broken like the first morning. Blackbird has spoken like the first bird. Praise for the singing, praise for the morning. Praise for them singing fresh from the rain's new fall, sunlit from heaven, like the first dewfall on the first grass. Praise for the sweetness of the wet garden, sprung in completeness where the sunlight, mine is the morning, born of the one light, Eden saw play. Praise with elation, praise every morning, God's recreation of the new
day. In the name of the Earth Maker, Pain Bearer, and Life Giver. This morning's reading, featuring Jesus healing the man born blind, describes more than a healing. It is a healing, of course, but the author of the gospel also uses this interaction to describe a blindness of a different sort than that which afflicts the eyes. The man healed by Jesus was obviously physically blind. The disciples, in their questions about whose sin had caused his blindness, the man or his parents, appear blind to innocent suffering. Surely, as much as they had been with Jesus and seen the things he had done, they had enough experience to know that such suffering existed. And they'd been with him enough to know that Jesus didn't react to a person's affliction by asking what sins they or others had committed. Jesus's response was only compassion and healing. The neighbors of the man can't see what is right in front of their eyes. This man whom they knew and who had been blind his entire life could now see. Even when he kept saying, "I am the man," they can't process it. They want to know how the man had been healed, and they want to know who the healer was. Like the disciples, they want a logical explanation for this miraculous event. And that human need to know obscured the truth they had witnessed for themselves. Finally, I think it's fair to say that the Pharisees were spiritually blind. To cure the blind man, Jesus makes mud and smears it on the man's eyes. To make mud was a violation of the law prohibiting work on the Sabbath. Jesus had broken a religious law. So the Pharisees conclude that he obviously is not from God. With their obsessive focus on the law, they are unable to see the transformative work that God is doing through Jesus. I think the lesson Jesus is imparting here is that we all, to one degree or another, struggle to see the truths that God lays before us. Like the disciples, how many of us get so caught up in the details, the minutiae of life, that we don't see the opportunities right in front of us to do something to ease suffering or improve the lives of others? Like the neighbors of the blind man, many of us are unable to appreciate the transformative way God works even when the evidence is staring us directly in the face. And like the Pharisees, we rely too much on human understanding and made-up doctrine and wind up missing the bigger lessons that God is trying to show us. I think one of the principal ways we demonstrate our own spiritual blindness is in our inability to see who we really are. Inundated almost from birth with family, social, religious, and other influences determined to dictate who we are, many, if not most of us, lose track of ourselves. It can take time for each of us to remember, to reintegrate the miraculous truth that we are all, and always have been, loved by a transcendent God. That we are, all of us, made in God's image. Sometimes we need God's help in hearing that truth, so fundamental that it should shape our entire existence. You are the beloved. In you, I am well pleased. Likewise, it can take time for us to recognize that this same cherished status extends to all of humankind. That God shared in our humanity in the person of Jesus, not for one person or one race or even one religion, but for everyone, everywhere. If God took human form in Jesus, who lived, taught, and was killed, to validate the inherent worth of humanity as God's creation, so too should we see that inherent worth in each other. But sometimes God has to remind us. Once our vision clears, we can see that it is in Christ that we find a common identity. It is the light of Christ that dwells in us, that calls us into love and service of others. Paul says to the church at Ephesus, "Once you were in darkness, but now in the Lord you are light. Live as children of the light, for the fruit of the light is found in all that is good and right and true." Because God demonstrated in Christ that we are all worthy of love, God expects us to recognize the same thing, to see in each other beings worthy of God's and therefore each other's love, and to extend that love generously to as many as we can in the virtually limitless ways that we can. We are living in a time in which darkness can seem to stalk us like a predator. In an age of pandemic, ecological devastation, greed, and rampant violence, it can be hard to hold feelings of disillusionment and resignation at bay. But friends, we have a hope in a God who has promised never to leave us. God tells us repeatedly, as in Joshua, "Do not be afraid, for I am with you wherever you go." Jesus took up the same message, as in Matthew, "And remember, I am with you always, even until the end of the age." And it is for this reason that I am convinced that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus, our Lord. God took on the human form of Jesus to teach us the way to combat darkness in all of its malevolent forms. And that way is the way of love. The remedy for the darkness of our present time lies in loving each other and caring for each other more. We are called to live as children of the light. May God continue to open our eyes to the specific ways we can be the light for each other and for our world.
Let us renew our faith by saying the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. God be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours. Help us, O God, our Savior.
Deliver us and forgive our sins.
Look upon your congregation.
Give to your people the blessing of peace.
Declare your glory among the nations.
And your wonders among all peoples.
Do not let the oppressed be shamed and turned away.
Never forget the lies of your.
Continue your loving kindness to those who know you.
And your favor to those who are true of heart.
Satisfy us by your loving kindness in the morning.
So shall we rejoice and be glad all the days of our life.
Gracious God, whose blessed Son, Jesus Christ, came down from heaven to be the true bread, which gives life to the world. Evermore give us this bread, that he may live in us and we in him, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
O God, you make us glad with the weekly remembrance of the glorious resurrection of your Son, our Lord. Give us this day such blessing through our worship of you, that the week to come may be spent in your favor, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. O God eternal, whose light divides the day from the night and turns the shadow of death into the morning, drive far away from us all wrongdoings, incline our hearts to keep your law, and guide our feet into the way of peace, that having done your will with cheerfulness during the day, we may, when night comes, rejoice to give you thanks through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. O God, you have made of one blood all the peoples of the earth and sent your blessed Son to preach peace to those who are far off and to those who are near. Grant that people everywhere may seek after you and find you. Bring the nations into your fold. Pour out your Spirit upon all flesh and hasten the coming of your kingdom, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen.
Prayers of the people. As a sign of our obedience, let us bend the knee of our hearts and make an offering of prayer and thanksgiving to God as we respond.
God have mercy.
That Christians throughout the world who are being persecuted for being followers of Christ may be protected by the strong armor of faith and sustained by the fervent prayers of all the baptized. Let us pray.
God have mercy.
That the work of God may be made visible through our weaknesses and shortcomings, bearing witness to others of the power of the Holy Spirit to overcome the heartache and despair that visits every human heart. Let us pray.
God have mercy.
For all who are preparing in their hearts for Holy Week and the great Paschal feast of Easter, let us pray.
God have mercy.
That those who have died may rest in peace, and we who hear of war and famine Remain restless until the day of peace has come. Let us pray.
God, have mercy.
Knowing that Jesus opens the eyes of the blind, gives voice to the voiceless, and frees those who are imprisoned by fear, let us with confidence continue our prayers.
God, have mercy.
From our parish prayer list this morning, we remember Thomas, Matt, Anna, Marilyn, Dennis, Earl, Susan, Steve, Ken, Cindy, Max, Raz, Alden, Susan, C. Clayton, Carrie, Brandy, Ron, Ann, Robbie, Jeffrey, Sally, Lucy, Louise, Carol, Katie, Anna Laura, Woody, John, Faldo, Dick, and Wayne. We pray for all of us throughout the world who are affected by COVID-19. We pray for the repose of the souls who have died. We pray for strength and perseverance for healthcare servants, scientists, families, couples, Carol, and Stephen. We also give thanks for this day of life. You may offer your own thanksgivings. Let us pray together the general thanksgiving. God of all mercies, we, your unworthy servants, give you humble thanks for all your goodness and loving kindness to us, to all whom you have made. We bless you for our creation, preservation, and all the blessings of this life, but above all for your immeasurable love in the redemption of the world by our Lord Jesus Christ, for the means of grace and for the hope of glory. And we pray, give us such an awareness of your mercies that with truly thankful hearts, we may show forth your praise, not only with our lips, but in our lives, by giving up ourselves to your service, by walking before you in holiness and righteousness all our days, through Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be honor and glory throughout all ages. Amen. Almighty God, you have given us grace at this time with one accord to make our common supplication to you. And you have promised through your well-beloved Son that when two or three are gathered together in his name, you will be in the midst of them. Fulfill now, O Lord, our desires and petitions as may be best for us, granting us in this world knowledge of your truth, and in the age to come, life everlasting.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Let us bless the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
May the God of hope fill us with all joy and peace in believing through the power of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Amen.